Now I had the opportunity to sit down with Ms. Davuluri, where we talked about everything from attracting more students into the STEM fields to some of her own personal struggles she's faced.
Nina, you spend much of your time here in Oklahoma talking with students about STEM, and that's part of your national platform for Miss America. Why did you choose that?
The Miss America organization has been promoting STEM education for 2 years now. And so I have the opportunity to work closely with the Department of Education, speak about STEM, specifically women in STEM, and travel across the country through various high schools, middle schools, colleges, and organizations to promote that.
Now, females now receive more higher degrees than males do, but when you look at the STEM fields, those numbers aren't that away. Mm-hmm. You know, you've met with these young girls today that are so excited about science and math. What happens between that time and when they become young ladies?
You know, I think it's hard because we often can't think outside of the box of what STEM career-related fields are. I think we think, oh, computer programmer, engineer, doctor, but there's so many more facets to STEM than just those that we normally think of. And so one of the messages I really like to send is that one of my friends went to graphic design school and now works for Whirlpool designing small kitchen appliances. That's something I would have never guessed that he would be able to do with a STEM field. As Miss America, we have a cosmetic sponsor, and I was able to go into the lab and create my own lip gloss with another woman who worked there. And that's a STEM-related field, too. So people just, I think it's important for high schools and colleges and universities to make aware of what other career paths are available through STEM.
Yeah, and it's really not a one-size-fits-all. There's
exactly.
A lot of different type of jobs. You don't necessarily have to have a PhD in something to be involved in the STEM fields.
Absolutely.
You are a second-generation American. Both your parents immigrated here from India. Yet you have traveled back to India to meet with family.
I have.
In your experience, how are young people in India, how do they approach education versus your friends here in the States?
You know, for me in my household, education was pushed ever since I can remember. It was something that we had to excel in. I mean, if I got a 96, it was, why not the 100? And that it was that constant, you have to be better, you have to be the best. Education is the key to success. And my parents will always say, my father will always say, I could not have survived in this country and provided the life that I was able to for my family if I did not have my education. And that's something that really resonated with me. And I think the largest problem with my generation, myself included, of course I'm included in it, in America, is that we have so much apathy for what is going on around in the world around us. From a young age, we were handed so much, we were given so much. And to have that mentality, that attitude to go out and seek something and work hard for something is very different than just sitting back and thinking, oh, well, it's just going to be handed to me, it's just going to be given to me. And I think that's the biggest difference between my generation and my parents' generation, because they've understood that value of hard work.
From early on in life, you've studied all types of dance, from tap to jazz.
I have.
But it was a Bollywood dance that you performed in the Miss America pageant, in spite of some people recommending that you not do that type of dance. Why did you choose that?
It was a huge part of who I was. My mom's side of the family is still in India, and we would go back every year, my sister and I, and we would learn this talent. I was classically trained in Bharatanatyam. And so for me, there was no question that if I was going to win Miss America, I had to do it in my own way and in my terms. And for me, Bollywood was who I was. It was a large part of my culture, my heritage. And to share something like that for the first time on a stage like Miss America, was really my moment, and winning Miss America was simply icing on the cake, I say sometimes, because now that's really introducing a new demographic to this organization and really encouraging young women to be proud of where they come from, who they are, and share that with others.
Unfortunately, when you did win Miss America, there were some xenophobic comments out in social media and that were just truly racist. Were you surprised by that? Were you taken aback by that?
You know, I wasn't, and that's because I had very similar remarks when I won the title of Miss New York. And when I won Miss New York, I was taken aback by it. I read my Twitter feed, I keep up with my social media. And when that happened, it was just, to me, was intolerable. These were educated people saying remarks like this. And I remember sitting down with my mom and sister thinking, goodness, why is this happening? And I've always viewed myself as first and foremost American. And hindsight really is 2020, because if that hadn't happened when I won Miss New York, I don't think I would have been ready or prepared or handled what happened when I won Miss America in the way that I did. And it really just goes to show how timely and how relevant my platform is. I didn't decide to just promote diversity through cultural competency when I won Miss America. It's something that I've been working very closely with for 3 years now. And so it's really given me a microphone to really talk about all these issues related to it and create a positive discussion.
And what are some of those issues that you share with audiences?
Well, you know, the thing that I've realized is that I started one of my own programs and organizations called Calling All Cultures, and I partnered with the YWCA, and their mission is eliminating racism, empowering women, which went hand in hand with what I was trying to do. And it's really not about opening a discussion about race, because that hasn't necessarily proven to be effective. I think what's really more effective is engaging children with hands-on activities. And we did different activities, whether simple things, you know, trying a different cuisine, learning a different instrument, talent, dance, language, whatever it may be, opposed to just having them sit in a lecture. It's really nice for them to be engaged and touch things and feel things. And that's what really helps break those stereotypes and get them excited.
Reading your bio today, by all accounts, you're a very motivated young lady. Yet you have struggled in your personal life with an eating disorder.
Absolutely.
Are those in any way related, the motivation there? Because I've known so many people in my own life that have struggled with eating disorders, and they are very motivated people.
Mm-hmm. I am very type A, and I think it was also very cultural for me in the sense that my parents really didn't necessarily understand what I was going through. And that's not to say that eating disorders don't exist in India, because they certainly do. But I think mental health globally has a stigma surrounding it that I certainly hope dissipates while more people are talking about it. And so for me, my dad was more understanding because he was a physician. My mom to this day will sometimes still say, why have you chosen to speak about this? It's such a personal issue. And when I have young girls who have come up to me and say, thank you for sharing your story because it's something that I'm going through, or now I feel comfortable to be able to ask for help, it's why I share my story. And more than anything, I've learned to stay balanced. Especially since I am type A, I am motivated. It's important to stay balanced, not only physically, but mentally, socially, emotionally, and spiritually as well.
Well, I do commend you for that. A final question. What's next for Nina Davuluri?
Well, I won $60,000 in scholarship money, and I'll be putting that towards my graduate degree, but I won't be able to start until the fall of 2015. So I kind of have a year window to play with, but right now I'm thinking about getting my MBA as well as my MD degree, so we'll see what happens.
All right. Wish you all the luck.
Thank you so much.